I want to share with you tonight the heart of a missionary. And when I think about the heart of the missionary, there's one person I think about in the Bible. Anybody have an idea who the one person that we might think about when we think of the heart of a missionary? Paul. Isn't that so simple? Paul just comes to mind immediately to our minds. And so I want you to find two places in the Bible. Find Acts chapter 16. We're going to be referring there in our introduction. And then after that, if you would, find the book of Philippians and chapter 1. And I think we have one verse in chapter 4 of Philippians. Okay, and I'm going to jump over to Philippians to just read a verse to get us started. And remember, this book of Philippians is being written by Paul while he's in jail. He's in Rome, and he's writing back to them because they've sent some help for him. And he's writing back to the church here. But Paul loved that church. And the verse I want to read is in Philippians 4, verse 1. And then we'll pray and get started. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord. My dearly beloved. This is Paul's feelings towards this church that he had planted some time before in his second missionary journey. And he writes back to them now that he's in jail and he can't go there. And he shares with them his heart. But let's have a word of prayer and we'll begin. Father, we thank you for your word.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Power that lies within it and how you use your word to encourage us. To help us stand fast and be able to withstand the trials and tribulations that come against our lives. Lord, we thank you for Paul, such a great example, such power that was used in his life to bring forth so many churches and so many lessons and things that we need for this life that we face. I pray you'll just bless us tonight. Use your word in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, in chapter 16, we come to Paul, and he's getting into Philippi. And there's three people I want to focus on right here, because these three people are the very basis for the church there in Philippi. And so I just want to quickly move down chapter 16. If you take notes, you could just put the verses that are important. And you can go back and read them later. But in verses 14 and 15, we find that the first thing as he's coming in, the first person he runs into is a woman. Verse 14 says, and a certain woman named Lydia. And then it says, a seller of purple. So as Paul's coming in, the first person that he runs into is this woman, and she's a businesswoman. So ladies, back all the way back then, they had business women. Amen? Yeah. She's a seller of purple. And so she was a businesswoman. And she heard Paul, the Bible says, which worshiped God. Now listen, she may not have been a Christian yet, but she was worshiping God. And there are a lot of people out here that we run into in the world that they're doing their best to worship God, but they need some help.
Right.
And so she's worshiping God. And it says, heard us. Now, it wasn't just Paul and Silas. There was others with them. It was a team, and they were going into a new place, and they're fixing to begin to pray and preach the word of God. And they run into Lydia, and when they run into Lydia, she heard them.
Amen.
Now, here it is. Listen to this. This is the root of it right here. whose heart the Lord opened.
Amen.
Now listen. Listen, we don't open people's heart.
Right.
We're not the ones that open it. It's the Lord. And Paul was on praying ground, and he was on good communication with God. And when he went and he spoke, she heard the word. And she knew that something must happen, and something needed to be done. And she heard them earnestly, and the Lord opened her heart.
Amen.
So that she could understand what she needed. And she understood, because right after that, it says, the Lord opened her heart, amen? And it says, that she attended unto the things that Paul spoke. Listen, if we want to see great things happen, and if we want to see people get saved, and we want to see God use our lives, we're going to have to take His word, but we better be praying that He's going to open the hearts that we run into. And that they'll be prepared and ready to listen and receive the things that we give them. So God opens the heart. Isn't that a great thing?
Amen.
We don't have to worry about opening the hearts, brother. What we got to do is preach the Word of God and share the Word of God. And God will open their heart. And they'll know that it's true. It's the message of God. And it needs to be received. Look what happened to her. And it says in verse 15, and when she was baptized, it says she was baptized and her household. She went home. She took what she heard. She had been worshiping God. Now she has the final part of what is needed to be close to God. And it's the pathway that was through Jesus Christ. And she has received Jesus Christ. And she goes home. Not Paul, not Silas, but she goes home and the whole household gets saved. The Bible says, and she was baptized in her household. Paul would have never baptized her household if they hadn't gotten saved. Amen?
Amen.
And she besought us, if we had judged her to be faithful to the Lord, to come into, she said, come into my house and abide there. Now I can imagine, Paul's, she's a brand new Christian, and Paul's saying, wait a minute. You know, we don't want to impose and all, but look what the Bible says. She constrained. It says, she constrained us. She said, listen, I will not take no for an answer. You have delivered unto me that one thing that I have been waiting on for years, and now I know God in a special way, and I want you to come into my house, and I'm going to take care of you while you're here in Philippi. She constrained them to take care of them. So that's our first person that we need to see. As Paul was going into Philippi, he runs into Lydia. Do you have a Lydia? Is there a Lydia out there somewhere? We have Lydias all over the Dominican Republic, amen?
Amen.
I'm always looking for a Lydia in the Dominican Republic. One that's ready. It's just like a piece of fruit picking from a tree. She was ready. Well, now we run into the second person in verse 16. It says, and it came to pass when they went out to pray. So now they've been there. They're being cared for. Now they go out to pray, it says in verse 16. And a certain damsel, possessed with a spirit of deviation, met us. And what is that? A spirit of deviation, which brought her masters much gain by smooth saying. Oh, that's a fortune teller. A fortune teller. They ran into a fortune teller. Someone that gave forth information that helped others become rich. And we see here that actually this damsel is a slave because she has masters.
Right.
So she's a slave. She has masters. It says there, brought her masters much gain. She was a smooth sayer. So here she is. She's possessed, she's giving information, she's making her masters rich. And then you have to understand, obviously this woman is well known as someone who gives forth troops. Because they're following her advice, and she's been making them a lot of money. So she's giving forth troops. Amen? She's known in the city.
Right.
It's someone's words that you can trust. Now look at this. And the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, Well, wouldn't it be great if you just go out witnessing and someone was following you around that was so well known by everybody and saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God.
Amen.
Which show unto us the way of salvation.
Amen.
Wow. Paul and Silas and his group are going down to pray for God's blessings upon the church planting effort of Philippi, and they have a woman that is known for telling the truth and making her masters lots of money, and she is following them and telling everybody that these are men of the Most, they're servants of the Most High God, and they are here to tell us the way to salvation.
Amen.
Wow, what a thing. Never saw that before. You ever see that before? I never saw that before. I was thinking, wow, she's broadcasting for them.
Right.
She's telling them these are good men. And these men have a message that will get you the way of salvation.
Right. Amen.
But after days, we find, and this she did many days, and Paul being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. Wow. Paul just showed that Jesus Christ not only would save them, but there was great power.
Amen.
If you believed that he could do something.
Amen.
And the Bible says within the hour, she was relieved of the Spirit. And we find there that when the Spirit was gone, her masters got upset, because all their money-making process had just changed. And they no longer could trust her. The reason they couldn't trust her anymore is because she became a new creature. Amen.
Amen.
2 Corinthians, right? 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature.
Amen.
Old things are passed away. All things become new. And all of a sudden, her masters were upset because the person that they had was gone. And now she's being led by the Holy Spirit of God.
Amen.
And now she's not worth anything to them. And they complain, and they bring Paul and Silas, and they're complaining to the magistracy. And the magistracy passes judgment upon them. We find this in verses 21 through 23. And he passes judgment on them. And he tore their clothes off, and he ordered that they be beaten. And we find there, it says in verse 23, that they had received many stripes. And after they had received the beating, they were cast into prison. And they charged the jailer and said, keep them safe. In other words, keep them so they cannot escape. Do not let them have any way or possibility to escape. And so the jailer said, you know what? In verse 24, he said, we're going to put them in the deepest part of the prison.
Right.
He said, we're going to take them to the deep part, and then we're going to put shackles on their feet so they can't get out. There's no hope for them to get out. And Paul and Silas could have been, at this point, upset, because they've gone into the city, and Lydia's been saved, and the girl possessed has been freed, and now she's saved, and she's walking in the Spirit of the Lord now.
Amen.
And all of a sudden, they're in jail. But not only are they just in jail, they got whipped for it. And they're in the deepest part of the jail. And they could have started complaining. They could have said, oh, what a plague is against us.
Right.
They could have started thinking about the virus that could come. We can't do anything. We can't go anywhere. We're going to be stuck here. They could have complained.
Right.
They could have got discouraged. They could have said, we can't do anything. We got to stop what we're doing. Things have to shut down. If we're in jail. That's not what they did.
Amen.
Look at verse 25. It says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. They didn't stop. Listen, hard times brought them into a mode of praying and singing and having great joy in their despair.
Amen.
Isn't that what it says in chapter 1 of James? To have the utmost joy in tribulation?
Right.
Tribulation should make us, trials should make us to bunker down, amen? To make a stand in life and say, hey, I'm going to do what God told me to do no matter what anybody tells me. No matter what anybody thinks, I'm going to do what God tells me to do. I'm going to serve the Lord. They begin to pray and they begin to sing. And in verse 26, there was a great earthquake. God shook the prison. The door fell off the prison and the shackles came loose. And here is Paul and Silas, and they're free, and they could take off, and they could run, and they could leave. But they didn't leave. They didn't leave. They stayed put. Reminds me in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. Listen to what Paul writes one day. He said, "For though we walk in the flesh," and that's us,
amen,
we still got our flesh.
But
look what Paul said about the Christian. We do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal.
Amen.
But mighty through God. To the pulling down of strongholds and casting down imaginations. And every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. And bringing into captivity. That's what we are. We can break down the strongholds. We can tear apart the evil that's against us. And we can bring the lost and cold and hard heart into captivity.
Amen.
With the Word of God. Amen?
Praise the Lord.
We're life changers.
Right.
That's the heart of a missionary.
Amen.
We're all missionaries at heart.
Amen.
If we love the Lord and we see people who need Christ, we are life changers. We possess an opportunity to give somebody new beginnings.
Amen.
That are founded on Jesus Christ.
Praise the Lord.
Things that cannot be changed or touched by Satan and his army.
Amen.
We are life changers. And Paul, as the prison guard, the jailer came, and he says, "Oh no, I was told not to let these guys out, and they're gone, and the doors are off the jail, and they probably have gone," and he sees it. And the Bible says he drew his sword in verse 27, and he would have killed himself. But in verse 28, Paul said, "Do thyself no harm, for we're all here."
Amen.
They didn't run. They weren't worried about that majesty. They were not worried about the fact that tomorrow may be an even worse day than they had faced that day. They stayed right there in the jail.
Right.
Why? Because they were equipped. They were equipped with the knowledge that God was on their side.
Amen.
And that they did not have to worry. And that they could depend on Him no matter how difficult it became or what they might face. They knew that God was with them.
Amen.
And they did not run out of that prison. They stayed put. And they said, "Don't do any harm." And why would they do that? Because God had something else that He needed them to do.
Amen.
Because we find in the next verse that the jailer says, the jailer says, "What must I do to be saved?"
Praise the Lord.
He says, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said to him, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house." Wow, three great things, all in just a few days, was happening. Why? Because Paul and Silas went to Philippi knowing that they were going to start a church there, having the vision of God, and not allowing anything that would possibly change what God had told them to do. And that's the way we have to be in this life. We've got to know what God wants from us.
Right.
We have to seek His face, and we have to pray, and we have to say, "God, I'm going forth today. I'm going to do Your will. I need You to open hearts, and I need You to change somebody's life today." And God is on our side.
Praise the Lord.
He will open the doors and He will allow us to walk through those doors and He will change lives.
Amen.
Because He has the power to open hearts. You see, this was the mind of Paul before he ever left to go to Philippi. Before he ever left on his first missionary journey, he had the missionary heart. He had the mind and set to do what God had told him to do.
Amen.
And now he's on his second trip. And we find now, as he's in jail, he's reflecting back. And he's thinking about all the things that God has done. And it comes to his mind about this church. And God, and Paul is writing to them to encourage them about the Lord. And letting them know that God is still on their side. And he encourages them and thanks them for what they've sent to him. And so I just want to point out three quick thoughts. You said, Brother Altra, if that introduction is anything that's going to happen with these other three points, we're going to be here all night. No, we're not. We're almost done. The introduction's long. Let's get to the meat. Amen. The first thing that was on Paul's mind in every missionary journey was people's lives had to be changed.
Amen.
People's lives had to be changed. When Paul started out on that missionary journey, the first one, second, third, when he started out on these missionary journeys, Paul had in his heart and mind that people's lives would be changed. Notice what it says there. Go back over to Philippians now. Over to Philippians right quick. And we're in chapter 1 now in Philippians. I'm going to get there. I must have took off my little paper clip. That's what I did. Boy, can't blame it on my kids because they're all grown and married and have I got grandkids. Well, here we go. So we're in Philippians chapter 1, and Paul says in verse 3, we're just going to breeze through this. Paul says, every remembrance of you. What is he remembering? He is remembering those one-on-one encounters as he went through that city and preached the gospel, and he, one by one, was winning people to Christ everywhere he went. Lydia got saved. After Lydia got saved, the damsel followed them for 3 days. She got saved. They got beat, thrown into the deep parts of the prison. The next day, after the earthquake, the jailer comes in. He gets saved. And the whole house got saved. Lydia's whole house got saved. Who knows who all got saved because that damsel had the deliverance of the Spirit. But I want to tell you something. Just after a few weeks, Paul went from nothing in Philippi to probably a whole congregation. Amen?
Amen.
Because he had the heart to see lives changed. It says there, Paul says in verse 4, making requests with joy. Paul said, listen, do not worry. Not only do I remember you, but I am praying for you. I bet you Pastor Terry spends hours every week praying for every member of this church.
Amen.
Because I know him. I know he has integrity. Paul said, making requests with joy. Then he says in verse 5, your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. He said, you guys have been on my mind from the first moment that God changed your life till today.
Amen.
That's what he's writing here. He's writing to them to encourage them, to help them to stand and know what they mean to him and what the work there means to him. And look what he says in verse 6. He says, being confident of this very thing,
amen,
that he which begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Listen, Paul knew that once Jesus did his work in a person's heart and soul, it was secure to the day of Jesus Christ. Nothing could be changed about it. Nobody can undo that. It is something that is permanent and it's eternal.
Amen.
Paul said, I know my Lord will continue to work with you and to change you. Three great moments in his missionary journey, and now we have the book of Philippians. The second thing, apart from seeing lives change, the second thing that was important and in his heart was that they stand fast and be fearless unto the end.
Amen.
That's something we should ask ourselves this evening. Am I standing fast? Am I easily shaken, or am I solid in the Word of God and who I am in Jesus Christ? And am I fearless? Can I handle opposition? Paul had opposition.
Right.
They came and got him. They arrested him. They beat him. They threw him into jail. And he started singing praises to God and praying. Amen. What do we do when the opposition comes against us? Do we fall apart? Do we get discouraged? Do we find ourselves looking for answers in the wrong places? Leaning on those who cannot help. Paul and Silas, they didn't lean on anybody except each other. And they began to pray and they began to sing praises to God. Look with me in verse 27. He says, at the end of that verse, he says, "Stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel." Isn't that great that God knows that we need others to stand with us?
Amen.
That's why they went out in a group. That's why they went out together. They needed to stand together. They were to stand together, and they were to have the one mind, one vision. That's what Paul and Silas in that group had. They had one complete vision that was all mixed together into one for all of them. It was the same vision. It was the same mind. It was the same message. Everything was unified. It's easy to stand when you got somebody standing beside you. Amen. It's easy to be strong when you're not by yourself. But let me tell you something. Jesus said he would never leave us nor forsake us. And when you find yourself by yourself and there's no one beside you, you just know that Jesus is right there with you and he has his right hand upon your shoulder. And he says, "Fear not." In Revelation chapter 1, Jesus said, "Fear not. I am the first. I am the last. I am he that was dead and liveth forevermore. And I have the keys of hell and hell. Death and hell," he said, "I have the keys." Oh, we have the great master beside
Praise
us.
The Lord.
And he's compassionate and he's merciful and he will help us through all the trials and tribulations that could come against us. Look at verse 28. It says, and in nothing terrified by your adversary. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be afraid of those that oppose us or come out against us. When I was in the Dominican Republic starting New Life Baptist Church, we rented a tent and we had over 200 people come out to the first service. And I preached and 26 people got saved. And the very next day, my secretary came to my office and she said, "Pastor, a bunch of trucks just pulled in here to the property and there's military people and they have rifles. And some of them have pistols, and they want to see you." And I was thinking, they want to see me? Why would they be here to see me? I haven't done anything. That was a Paul Silas moment right there, let me tell you. And I'm thinking, why are these people here with these guns? And why are they so against us after a great day that we had yesterday?
Amen.
I said, "Bring them in." They came in, and I noticed that I used to be in the military. I noticed that one of the guys had his pistol cocked. And I was like, "Sir, you don't have to have a gun in here because we ain't got no guns." I said, "We don't have no guns." So he put his gun away. I said, "Why are y'all here?" He said, "Well, we have a formal complaint that you are here and that the church is just a front for a business of selling exotic animals." Exotic animals. I said, we don't have any exotic animals. Did you see any exotic animals when you came into our building? No, no, we didn't see any, but we know you got them. I said, well, please find them and bring them to my office so I can see them. I said, but beware in the back over there because I have a big Rottweiler and he will bite you. I said, that's the only exotic animal I have in the place, a Rottweiler. And he would have bit them too, let me tell you, he would have. I said, well, we're sorry. We still got to take everything here you got. I said, you going to take my chairs? I'm going to take your chairs. You going to take my tables? Yeah. He said, not only that, we're going to take your desk and all of your equipment and everything. We're taking it all. That's what the trucks are for. I said, really? I said, wait, let me make a phone call. So I made a phone call. We had a friend that worked in the president's office of the country. And I told her what was going on. She said, let me talk to that man. She wants to talk to you. Now, I don't know what she said, but I could hear that she was very upset and it was very loud coming out of the phone. But she said things that I don't even have an idea what they were. But when she got done, he handed me the phone and she said, they're leaving. But you have offended the neighbor across the street by bringing a Baptist church, and he's a devout Catholic, and he wants you gone. And she said, there's no way you're going to get out of this. Well, she was right. They said, they put a lock. They said, you can't go in, you can't preach, you can't do anything. I just took the church over to our house and started having services in our house. We had Shelton Smith come in. I had to go pick him up at the airport on the way back. I said, now, Brother Shelton, when we get over there to the where the church is, you'll see a big old banner. It says, Kick Out New Life Baptist Church. The guy next door put that big banner up on both sides of the street to kick us out, and they kicked us out. So I said, we're going to be meeting in my carport. Could you see Shelton Smith in the carport preaching, brother? So he was for a whole week. But you know what? Just the following week, I went right down the street. I found a house that was twice the size that we had rented. It was for the same amount of money.
Amen.
And we didn't have to do anything, hardly anything, to move into the place. And within 1 week, we moved to a much better location on the main street that went right down the middle of the city. You know what the price of 26 souls were? You know what the price of 26 souls were? $28,000. That was God's price. We did all that work. We spent all that money to get that place ready. We had no idea we'd only be there for a week. We didn't get discouraged.
Amen.
God must have something else. He's got something better. We can't be fearful. And then in verse 29, it says, For unto you it is given, now listen to this, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Listen, don't get down when the suffering comes, because we've never been told that we would not suffer. We've never been told that it's going to be easy.
Right.
Sometimes we will suffer.
Amen.
But Paul says in verse 1 of chapter 4, he said, So stand fast in the Lord.
Amen.
That's what Paul's message to them was. Stand fast. Hold your ground.
Right.
Don't give up. And then the last thing on Paul's heart was to make sure that they knew that he was not discouraged, nor was he bothered that he had suffered so many trials and tribulations, not only there in Philippi, but throughout the entire ministry that Paul had. As we trace it step by step by step, shipwreck, deserted, wading in the ocean two or three times, hungry, without. Paul said in verse 1, chapter 1, verse 12 of Philippians, He says, it was for the furtherance of the gospel.
Amen.
He said, the things I went through, the things that I had to suffer, the things that I had to get past to get to the Roman prison was for the furtherance of the gospel. He says, but I would, you should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. Paul said, don't feel bad for me, I'm in prison. Don't feel bad that I've had to suffer some things and go through some things to get the word of Jesus Christ to these people. Don't feel bad for that. He said in verse 13, so that my bonds in Christ are manifested. He said, the things that have happened to me, the testimony of what I have suffered has been manifested in all the palace and in all other places. Paul said, don't worry. He said in verse 14, he said, and waxing confident by my bonds are much more bold. He said, the brethren is much more bold to speak the word without fear. We're to speak the word. We're to press forward no matter what's happening. That's our vision in the Dominican Republic.
Amen.
Not to be stopped.
Right.
To keep going forward. Not to get tired. Not to get overcome. Not to get discouraged. But to continue on pressing forward.
Right.
You know, I'm so grateful to the church for all your help. Just like Paul was writing back, I'm so grateful to all the churches who have made great sacrifice that we could do a great work for God in the Dominican Republic. Let us enjoy that people's lives are changed.
Amen.
Let us stand fast without fear in the work of God. And let us always remember, no matter what we endure, it was for the gospel's sake.
Amen.
For the furtherance of the gospel. Pastor Terry.